Hello everyone, in this video we will study about network layer. We can see the network layer below the transport layer and above the data link layer in TCP/IP as well as OSI module. So we'll start with the introduction. We know that network layer, it's going to provide the host to host delivery of the packet. It is also called as source to destination delivery or machine to machine delivery of the packets or segments. So this is done based on the addresses. So here we are going to use the logical addresses, and logical addresses are also called as IP addresses. So IP address, it's going to consist of two parts. First one is the network ID and second one is the host ID. So here the forwarding or routing, it is performed by the network layer. So whenever the source want to send the packet to the destination, it is moving the packet from one network to the another network, and each network will have different host within that. So it will be delivered to the proper host within the destination, within the other network. So if we consider the IP address consists of network ID to which the packet need to be forwarded, to which network the packet need to be destined, and within that network to which particular host the packet need to be delivered, that is also stored. So IP address, it consists of network ID as well as the host ID within that network. So the packet delivery, it is done through the IP addresses, or it is also called as a logical address. So here transport segment, from sending to the receiving host, so it's going to send the packet from sending to the receiving host, and on sending side it is going to encapsulate the segments into the datagrams. So it is going to receive the data, the network layer is going to receive the segments from the transport layer, and those segments are converted, or they have been encapsulated in the datagrams. So datagram, it's going to contain a segment as well as the header. So header followed by the segment, that is what we call it as a datagram. So on the receiving side, it's going to deliver the segments to the transport layer. So on the receiving side, the network layer, it's going to receive the segments, and it's going to pass those segments to the transport layer, which is the above layer. Network layer protocols in every host as well as in the every router. So here we can see the network layer protocol in each and every host as well as in the routers. So if we consider a router, each router consists of three layers. The first one is network layer, next we have the data link layer, and the last one is a physical layer. So every intermediate device, it consists of all the layers, but the packet or segments that flows from source to destination, it will move in the intermediate nodes till the three layers, that is the below three layers up to network layer. So here router examines the header field in all the IP datagrams passing through this, that is here at the routers or any intermediate devices, they are going to examine the header field of the IP datagram that are going to pass through it. So here if suppose you want to send the packet from here to the destination, which is in the some other network, so here the data or the datagram, it passes from this source to a router. Here router is going to find the IP address of that packet at the network layer. So at the network layer, it's going to find the IP address to which it has been destined, and it's going to forward that packet to the next router. Again, this router, it's going to check for the IP address which is found at the network layer. Again, it's going to decide what will be the next router to which the packet need to be forwarded. So every time it moves up to the network layer to check for the IP address, and then it's going to forward the packet to the next routers or to the next intermediate devices. So here we have an example. We have the source and we have the destination, which are present at two different networks. So here we have the application layer, and next we have the transport layer. So application layer sends the data to the transport layer, and transport layer, it will be converted into segments, and it will pass it to the network layer. Network layer, it's going to encapsulate those segments into a datagrams by adding the header. Then it will be passed to the data link layer. So at the network layer, it's going to add the IP address of the source as well as the destination. Then it will pass to the data link layer, next to the physical layer. So here the functionality of the network layer, it's going to provide the host to host delivery or source to destination delivery. So here network layer is going to provide end-to-end delivery. That is, here you have the source and here we have the destination. So the packet need to flow from source to destination, or from this host the packet need to reach this host. So it is called as a host-to-host or end-to-end delivery of the packet. Now you can see here we have many intermediate nodes through which the packet need to flow. So here we have different routers, and through all these routers the packet moves up to the network layer to check for the IP addresses. We'll just check how the packet moves here. You can see a packet is, it will reach the destination. You can, just now we saw the length of the packet. Let's check here. Length, it increases because it's going to add the header. At the network layer the header is removed and only the data gets delivered at the application layer. So here how the packet will be transmitted from router within the routers within the network, this is decided by the data link layer, but source to destination delivery, it is provided by the network layer. So here are some of the functionalities of the network layer. First one is forwarding and second one is the routing. Forwarding is move the packets from router's input to the appropriate router's output, and routing is determining the route taken by the packets from source to destination. So here we have the analogy, this is going to be helpful. That is, routing, it is a process of planning trip from source to destination. Forwarding is process of getting through single interchange. That is, if you consider it as a forwarding, then you are going to forward the packet. That is, in case of routing, you are going to decide the path from source to destination before sending the packet. That is, you are going to plan everything, that how the packet will move into the network, through how many intermediate nodes it has to pass, it has to move, and how it is going to reach the destination. Everything is defined and it has been saved in the header before sending the packet from source. So all the information is pre-planned based upon the routing algorithms, and then you are going to send the packet into the network so that the packet follows the same path and same procedure and it will reach the destination. So it is called as a routing. But in case of forwarding, you being a source, you send the packet to the immediate next neighbor or to the intermediate node. So that intermediate node decides where it has to move further. Again, those intermediate nodes, they are going to decide where the packet need to move further. So here we can consider that router, it is a intelligent device and it contains some routing algorithms within it, and based on that it's going to decide where the packet need to be forwarded. So here they have taken some traveling example here. So it is a process of getting through single interchange. Here you are not going to plan the entire trip earlier, just you are going to plan that where you are going to move next, and as soon as you reach that that place, you are going to decide where you are going to move next. So at the intermediate place you are going to decide what is your next immediate destination. So that process, it is called as a forwarding. So here we have a routing table, that is, it is also called as forwarding table. So here that forwarding table, it is decided based upon the routing algorithm. So routing algorithm, it's going to do determine end-to-end path through the network. So this routing algorithm, it's going to give the end-to-end path from source to destination. So before sending the path, before sending a packet, you are going to decide the entire path. That is done through routing algorithm. So here we have some of the routers, and we know that the routing table, it maintains the forwarding table. So that table, it is called as a local forwarding table. So here each router have their own local forwarding tables. So here we have an example. This is the routing table or forwarding table of this router. Suppose if this router receives a packet with a header value as 0100, then it will be sent through an output link as 3. Then it will be that packet will be transmitted to this link. Right now it has received with 0111, So the we can see a packet with the header as 0111. So it is going to look into its routing or forwarding table. Here we can see 0111. When it is 0111, it will be sent to output link as 2. So we can see with the red mark here, the packet it will be forwarded to link 2. So the router it's going to decide what will be its through which link it is going to forward the packet. It is done through the forwarding or routing table. So all the values they are been stored in the forwarding table, and based on this it is going to forward. So here it will be passed to through link 2, and here it is going to arrive. And again this routing router it has its own forwarding table which is similar to this, and based on that it's going to forward the table forward the packet further. So forwarding table determines local forwarding at this router where the packet need to be forwarded. So here we have used the term forwarding. Forwarding is at each router it's going to decide where the packet need to be forwarded next, but the path is not predefined. So here we have the header as 0111. It has been received. So it's going to decide to which output link it need to be sent. So the next one is about the connection setup. Connection setup is you are going to send the packet from source to destination, and the routing tables they are going to decide the path. After the path has been decided, the path setup need to be done from source to destination. So here there are three types of paths. First one is a physical path that we are going to call it as a TCP path, and second one is a virtual path, and the third one is no connection is being established, the packet move randomly. The first one is TCP path. In case of TCP, we usually say that the physical connection has been established from source to destination and the packet move within that physical path, then it is a connection oriented. Next one is virtual connection. Virtual connection is logical connection. Logical connection is the path is actually not established, but in its mind you assume that the path is existing and you just follow the same path that was stored in your mind. So the path is not physical, like we cannot see it, but it is in your mind and you are going to follow the same path. Then it is called as a virtual connection. That is, it does not exist, but you assume that it's going to exist. And the third one is no path is being established. In that case, the packet moves randomly in the network because the path is not established. So here, one of the functionality of the network layer is the connection setup and forwarding the packets. So here, some of the examples, ATM, frame relay, and X.25, they are going to use this architecture. So before datagrams flow, two end host and interweaving routers establish a virtual connection and routers get involved. Why routers get involved is, here router is considered as a resource, and all the resources from source to destination they are reserved for the specific purpose, that is to send the packets or segments from source to destination. So all the resources that are in a path, they all are reserved for this purpose. Networks versus transport layer connection services. So network layer, it's going to provide the service between two hosts, that is it's going to provide the host to host delivery of the packet or source to destination delivery of the packet, whereas transport layer, it's going to provide a connection between the two processes. So transport layer, it's going to provide the process to process delivery, and it is also called as end to end delivery of the packet. So here it works usually from process to process, whereas it is between the host. So a process may contain many hosts. So here we have the network service model. Network service model, it is considered as what are the services that are provided by the network layer, that is the services offered by the network layer. So here are some of the services. First one is example service for individual datagrams. When you are considering the individual datagrams, first one is guaranteed delivery. This service guarantees that the packet will eventually arrive at its destination. That like you are not going to specify any time limit or time bound, but it's going to arrive at the destination. But the second one is, that is guaranteed delivery with bounded delay. That is there has been specified the time limit as 40 milliseconds delay. That is, this service not only guarantees the delivery of the packet, but delivery within the specified host-to-host delay bound. That is, it's going to specify the time limit, and within that time limit, the packet need to arrive at the destination, which is specified as less than 40 milliseconds. Next one is about the example services for a flow of datagrams. So in this case, you are not sending the individual datagram and you are waiting for the acknowledgement. You are sending a set of datagrams. In that case, how it's going to work? The first one is in order datagram delivery. That is, or in order packet delivery. This service is going to guarantee that packets arrive at the destination in the order in which they were sent. So it is called as in order delivery of the packets. The second one is guaranteed minimum bandwidth to flow. So here the network layer, it's going to behave similar to that of the transmitting layer. That is, it is mainly because of the bit rate. That is, when you are calling it as a bandwidth, the bandwidth usually it need to be reserved from source to the destination, and if it is a connectionless, then whenever the bandwidth is available, only in that case it need to send the packet. Suppose you are going to reserve some bandwidth, that is, you consider the example as 1 Mbps bandwidth is available, then the transmitting rate of the package, it should be such a way that 1 Mbps bandwidth it is able to accumulate, and it is going to accept the packets, and it will be able to deliver the packet to the destination properly. So based on the available minimum bandwidth, the sender need to send the packets, and so that the receiver is able to accept it. The third one is restrictions on changes in the inter-packet spacing. So here, inter-packet spacing, that is, you send one of the packet first, and you wait for certain amount of time, and you send the next packet. That is called as inter-packet spacing. When you are sending large number of packets, that is a bulk of packets, then you are not going to send one next to the another. There has to be a certain time bound or time limit between the two packets to which you are sending the packets. So here, restrictions on changes in inter-packet spacing. Next, we have some of the applications and which kind of network architecture they are going to use, and what kind of service that are being provided. The first one is internet. Internet is going to provide the best effort service. That is, it's going to try its maximum to deliver the packet. Bandwidth guarantee, no, it's not going to guarantee. Next, we have the no loss guarantee. Ordering. Any possible order it may be received, but if you find a buffer, then it is able to store it. Timing is not maintained, and explicit congestion feedback is not provided in case of internet. Next, we have the ATM, and we have the constant bit rate. When it is a constant bit rate, you are going to send the packets at the constant rate. And here we have the loss, that is, loss guarantee it is provided. Next, we have the in-order delivery of the packet. Yes, it is provided because we have the buffers. And we have the timing. Timing mechanism is also maintained. And congestion will not occur. Here, when it is a constant bit rate, the receiver is able to receive the packets, and no congestion is going to occur in this case. When there is no congestion, no explicit feedback is required. The third one is about ATM and variable bitrate. In this case also, congestion does not occur, and the loss guarantee or in order delivery of the packets and timing, everything is guaranteed. Next, we have the ATM, ABR, that is available bitrate. Next, guaranteed minimum, that is, bandwidth may not be available. Here, loss is, that is, in case of bandwidth, it's not guaranteed. And loss tolerant, it is not provided. And in order delivery of the packet, it is going to provide. And timing is not maintained here. The packets may arrive whenever they want. There is no guarantee that, there is no bond that has been specified on the timings. And here, in case of ATM ABR, the congestion feedback mechanism is provided, and this is done through the intermediate nodes or network assistant. That is, the networks, it's going to provide explicit feedback indicating that there is a congestion. Next one is ATM and UBR. It's not, the bandwidth is not guaranteed, loss and timing is not provided, and no external feedback is provided by the networks or from the end-to-end devices. Thank you.